So when we present our results, we can often get a little bit carried away and only really focus on the big, exciting new findings. For example, our exciting new variety of sorghum, we've bunched it into our analysis and found out that we have a significant improvement in the yields for new variety compared to older variety. And we've got yields that are 15% higher. So we might be very excited by this, and we can start getting our p-values and making impressive looking bar charts here, but we're missing something important. Because there's lots of data which goes into that, and not all of our farmers are the same. Within each of our treatments, some farmers are getting higher yields, some farmers are getting lower yields. And if we'd recruited different farmers into our trial, we'd have perhaps seen something slightly different. Would it have still been 15%? So these results, this 15% and the p-value, it's not that it is incorrect, it's just it's missing a little bit of context. So thinking about that 15% increase, is that the mixture of, say, every farmer having a small increase? Or do some farmers have a really big increase and other farmers have a slight decrease? Trying to explain this, these are two very different scenarios which can both get to that 15% figure. And with that 15% figure, how much uncertainty do we have in that? If we had a different supply of farmers, would we be getting that 15% again? Or would we be unsurprised if it came out 20% or 10% or 50%? How much confidence do we have in that 15%? And we rarely ever see results like this presented without a p-value or a bunch of stars, but this p-value is such a narrow concept linked to a very specific hypothesis. So having precision and variability both being communicated will really help people better understand your results. And there is quite a key difference between precision and variability. So variability, we're thinking about differences across the data that we have, which we then extrapolate up to the whole population. So we're thinking about some farmers having higher yields and some farmers having lower yields. So the level of variability we have, it's not dependent on how much data we have, but it's dependent on what it is that we are measuring. The precision refers to the uncertainty in the estimates that we're getting from the data. So if we were to have more farmers in our trial, we might have more precise estimates because we'd have more data going into that. We'd be more certain that the figure of 15% was indeed an accurate figure. So the level of precision we have increases as our sample size also increases. But we're still thinking in terms here of the level of precision in our estimates across perhaps multiple trials. If we did another trial, would we expect to see the same results? What would be a reasonable, similar value to be seeing in another trial of the same sort? And we need to think of presenting them both, like I say, because they are different and they capture very different aspects, and both of them are contextually important. So when we're thinking of variability, the concepts that are most commonly talked about here, you think of standard deviation or variance, and these do have very useful statistical properties, but they're often quite poorly understood as concepts in their own right for a more general audience. So certainly for a paper, these should be presented, but in a presentation, there's maybe better ways of dealing with it. One way of thinking of a standard deviation can be to say, okay, let's multiply this by 2, and then if we add that and take it away from the mean, that gives us a range for where we think most of our data, 95% of our data might be. But that's all a little bit fiddly and complicated to work out in your head. And it's only really valid if we have a symmetrical distribution of results as well. Which is why trying to think of other ways of presenting it, maybe coefficient of variation, the ratio of the standard deviation to the mean, or the range of values, but the range of values can be quite influenced just by one or two outliers at either end, or perhaps the interquartile range, so the range from the 25th percentile to the 75th percentile. Again, that takes a little bit of contextual thinking, but this is why I think for variability, graphs are a much better way of summarizing it than numbers. And there's lots of good options here. So scatter plots can show you all the data, but if you've got a lot of data, they're not quite so good, which is where summary type plots like a box plot or a histogram or a cumulative frequency plot, all of these can show you the summary of the data in a slightly better way and still capture that variability. So the box plot is obviously linked quite closely to the interquartile range for showing you the lower quartile and the upper quartile as the ranges of that box, which gives you a good idea of the variability, especially comparing across groups. The histogram shows you the distribution And as part of that, we can see the variability through that distribution. Again, whether it's a large amount of variability and how it varies across groups. Cumulative frequency plots convert your data here to percentiles. And again, they're very useful for comparing through the range of values to see how different groups are behaving at the lower end, the medium, and the top end of values. Then you've got more interpolated plots, like a violin plot, which is actually the same as a density plot, but just mirrored across and flipped around the other way. But these can sort of help if we've got a bit of a spiky histogram or a spiky box plot by smoothing those distributions and trying to, again, plot it to emphasize the variability across the range. But all of these are good potential options and are worth exploring. And most of them communicate these issues of variability. How much is there? How does it vary across the groups? In a much better way than thinking about standard deviations or other summary statistics. With precision, we often think here about standard errors or confidence intervals. So this standard error, this is our standard deviation of the estimate itself, not the standard deviation of the population. So this is linked to the standard deviation, but also to the sample size that we have. So as we increase the sample size, our standard error gets smaller. So usually we use the standard error in conjunction with a confidence interval. So the confidence interval gives us a range of values where we think the true value of the thing that we are estimating may lie. Conventionally, we'll go with a 95% confidence interval. Sometimes we might go with a 90% confidence interval, have less confidence, which would give us a narrower interval. Or sometimes we might go for a 99% confidence interval. And if we increase that, that means that we're having higher chance of the estimate lying in that range, but that means the width that we are having for that confidence interval is wider. So we're allowing more possible values within that range. Visually, this will nearly always be represented with error bars. But a really key thing to remember is different software packages and also different specialisms make different default assumptions about what an error bar is, whether it's a standard error or a 95% confidence interval or a 99% confidence interval. So just putting a plot with error bars without any labeling will be interpreted by different people in different ways depending on what they're used to. So we really need to be clear on labeling what it is that we've got there. And never use error bars for variability, which is something else I've seen before with error bars for standard deviation, because that goes against everybody's conventional expectations. So it's just going to confuse your audience. And it's also a really poor way of representing variability compared to all the options that we just talked about. So always remember to contextualize your results by presenting the variability and the precision in there, because without that, those key headline findings don't have the same level of credibility and can't be contextualized by your audience. And you don't need to use every single option that I'm talking about here. Just some way of showing variability and some way of showing precision, probably in different displays and different summary statistics. So with variability, plots are always a better option. And with precision, you are likely going to be presenting some plots which show your trends and show your key results. So including error bars alongside those plots will be probably the most efficient way of conveying that. And these concepts like standard errors and standard deviations and variances, they're very useful statistical components, but they're not super easy for your audience to really understand. So really try to think of how can I be explaining this in a way that people will follow and understand without having to do a lot of mental mathematics and trying to remember exactly what a standard error and a standard deviation is.